Yeah.
My housebreaking, or before the housebreaking, I think I got a gun manging maybe being in a 10 or 11.
Mm.
Yeah, mang toli gun.
Sure.
And because I said MP, nyana nkata, business, whatever, comrades and da-da-da. So, ng toli gun, ng chaff, gave it to my elder brother and I wife. Came back from boarding school, mina na ye, we did things together, you know, but ikan besi seven samasyo kwachisa banya band, you know, that type of thing, yes. Yeah. So,
welcome to the Safe Space Chats podcast with Madam Speaker. My name is Perseverance Maremeni, also known as Madam Speaker, also known as the CEO of Self Love. If you're joining in for the first time, welcome to the family of healing, self love, and motivation. And if you're returning, thank you so much for the continuous love and support that you are showing me. A big shout out to Sen Studios, our home. A big shout out to Crown Liners for always making me look like a queen. A big shout out to Itu Hair Studios for always doing my hair. And also a big shout out to Hydro Quench, even though the water is not here with us today. But we appreciate you guys and we thank you. We have a guest today, a life-changing story that we're going to be listening to today. But I'm going to allow our guest to introduce himself and then we take it away. Hi, my brother.
Hi, how are you?
I'm good, thanks. How are you?
Yeah, I'm actually grateful to be here on this platform.
Thank you so much.
On YouTube, it's actually a big one.
Yeah.
And you're doing a great work.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, so to begin with, how do I put this? When I introduce myself, I say I'm a godly man.
Okay.
That's the first thing, because I respect God more than anything else. And then my name is Trinity Msibi. That's the name I use. Yeah. So.
Okay.
I wouldn't say much about me except when...
You don't want to give yourself credit.
Yeah, you know.
You know, in life, you need to read your own obituary while you're still alive.
Yeah, perhaps when we're speaking now and continuing with the talk and then,
then we get
up.
To...
Yeah, you know, get to put
overview.
The pieces together and find out who am I.
Okay. Yes. All right. It's nice to meet you, my brother. Just give me a background of you growing up. Where were you raised?
Okay, yeah. Well, I'm from LX. Okay. I was born and raised in LX.
Okay.
Though I had a tour, you know, being raised from one household to another by one person to another, you know, that kind of thing. So I actually don't know my father.
Okay.
Never, you know, knew him. And then I had my mother who actually begot me and never actually cradled me or nurtured me as what mothers would do with their toddlers.
Mm-hmm.
I think up until the age of 4 months, if I'm not mistaken, but, you know, I cannot recall everything that happened back then, but it was there when I'm told the history about my upbringing.
Yeah.
So what happened from that 6 months, I moved from LX and then I'm taken to Soweto because my grandmother now is supposed to work because my mother had left me with the grandmother.
Yeah.
So now she had to work and then I had to move from this place, going to another, you know, in Soweto. Stayed a few, I think 2 months or so, and moved from Soweto in Deep Kloof to another part in Soweto, like Emzimhlophe.
Okay.
Now, when I'm there, I had to stay there about... I think until I was 2 years old.
Mm-hmm.
And then from then on, 2 years old, I go to Orange Grove now. This is closer to Alexandra.
Mm-hmm.
So there it is my aunt. I called her my aunt, but she was a sister to my grandmother.
Okay.
You know, so I was raised by her from that age up until I'm 6 years,
okay.
6 years of age. Now, when I'm six, she's involved with a boyfriend,
okay.
You know, coming from... Giyani.
Okay.
Yes. And then we had to move to Giyani, me and her, because apparently she had told the boyfriend I'm the child,
okay.
You know, and everybody else knew she's my mother. And I as well knew she's my mother.
She didn't have kids of her own?
No. Okay. She was actually barren. I don't know if that's a good word to you. But yeah.
Okay.
She was
barren. How the Bible states it, by the way.
You know, yes. But she didn't, have child of her own. So here... We go to this place in Giyani. I think it was in Kwamalamlela. I'm just not sure. Or Kwabungeni, but I know the two names have always resonated with my,
there is,
you know,
Kwabungeni and Malamlela.
And Malamlela. So I don't actually remember quite well which part of the two I was in. Yes. So when she gets there, she's surprised, you know. The guy has a wife and she's there to become a second wife.
Okay.
And then she runs away. Now, she had come, like she had brought me with her, but when she runs away, I'm no longer, you know, taken with, and then I remain behind.
Ha!
and with people I don't know, mm-hmm. and people which she don't know either. So I had to be, you know, raised there for like, say 18 months or 2 years or so, because I went to school there for like 2 years. And then I didn't know my grandmother on this other side, she actually was looking for me.
Mm-hmm.
And then him long selile kiani, I'm speaking Tsonga, mm. I'm learning Tsonga, I'm at school, I'm excelling in Tsonga and everything like mm-hmm. that. So I had to, you know, to be looked for and found and then brought back to Alex and then begin school and everything like that. So, you know the family dynamics when it comes to a child of my caliber, mm-hmm. you know, whereby your mother is also neglected you mm-hmm. and you don't have a father and you actually are everybody's child,
yeah.
you know, yes. So when I got back to Alexander, after my grandmother had sourced information, because my aunt wasn't giving information, even if she was giving information, it was vague because here she was, she went to this Guyana, she actually doesn't know, it was her first time going there, mm-hmm. you know, and then she left me there because she was running away.
Yeah.
So I also suffered and endured some things, you know, gruesome things that they did to me, you know, the abuse and stuff like that, how they treated me.
You are like a stranger to them.
Like, I'm a stranger, you know, yes. And I think maybe they feel this one thinks is important because coming from Joburg and da-da-da-da-da-da, you know how it is, especially when there are your peers there growing up in the same house, you know. So... yeah, it became that, but they found me finally. Mm-hmm. Then I was brought back, you know, sent like a package being mm-hmm. posted, you know, through Ipasi. Then Genepasi in Yoshiga Park Stage, and then somebody collects me there, and then we go to my grandmother's working place. You know, she was a maid, a Makishin in the suburbs, white people's houses. Mm-hmm. That's where she worked. So went there, took a bath. I still remember that vividly, you know, taking a bath. The person who was actually washing my body was my uncle, but he was 2 years older than me.
Okay.
So at the time when my grandmother went to work, she also had a toddler, you know.
Oh,
so, you know, he was 2 years older than me. And then we grew up together, you know, yes. And even from when I came back, we grew up together.
Mm-hmm.
So here we were in this place in Lombardy East. And then she has to figure out, how do I take these people and then live with them together in the township? You know, it was actually a crazy thing to like for her to think about. Well, nevertheless, yazike elokshini zokhula nonke. But obviously, the grandmother is not a mother to me.
Yeah.
But when I came back, you know, being a child and the mind is still kelo, is not that matured and stuff, then you start thinking, oh, this is my mother, you know, because your other mother actually abandoned you there and then you grew some emotions and hated or hated her or felt that she actually, you know, neglected you, and then you're thinking, no, this is not my mother, you know. Like everybody else who had actually tried to cradle me and take care of me, I thought they are my mother, you know. So... in Soweto Mzimhlophe, there was somebody who's my aunt. I thought she was my mother. In Orange Grove, the one who left me. In Kiani, I thought she was my mother. And then here I am now, my grandmother, now seeing her now with a little bit matured mind as opposed to when I was a little you know, child. Yes. So now I'm seeing this because she's doing everything that, you know, she can for me. Obviously, because this uncle of mine, and we are almost the same age, is there and is her last born child. She wouldn't obviously, you know, do equally for us. And you know how demanding last borns can be to their mothers and stuff like that. So she would try, hide some things, you know, show other things to be equal, you know, before us. And then, you know, behind the curtain, she would give whatever she would give. But she tried to hide it, but you know, it's never...
obviously,
you know,
it always shows. It's going to show. The spoiled bread always shows.
You understand, yes. They're going to say... Minang Funi All Star. And at that time, that's too expensive. And that's a trend with, you know, young boys and stuff in the township. And then you wouldn't get, he would get, you might get, you know, an imitation
Ampor,
of that.
Ampor All Star. Yeah.
Actually, yes, Ampor All Star. Yeah. You know, she's trying. Mm. And sometimes you wouldn't get anything, you know. So that's when I started weighing these things now. And I'm starting to try put the puzzle to like the puzzle pieces together. I'm like, is this my mother?
Yeah.
And obviously there's, you know, whisperings, whispers that come, you know, they say, okay, your mother is sorry and so. And I'm seeing my mother, by the way, because my mother is the firstborn to the grandmother.
Okay.
I am seeing her when she comes back from wherever she comes from, coming to the house. She would never even, you know, play, you know.
So it's like she was disconnected from you.
Like utterly disconnected. Mm-hmm. She wasn't actually, you know, there. But here's the thing with that. It actually didn't matter at the time, but at the same time, it did matter. You know, grandmom was there, but grandmom was showing signs of favoritism. So you can understand that I'm confused. I think grandmother is my mother, but she doesn't like me enough, like last ones should be, you know, loved and stuff like that. So I see my mother coming in the house sometimes, you know, when she come from wherever she comes from. And I'm like, okay. And then somebody else says, this is your mother, but I don't believe them because there's another sister who comes after her, and that one loves me dearly. You know, she is so inspirational, telling me about how education is so pivotal for me to grow this and that and that. And she made me, you know, to love reading and stuff like that. Yeah. So here we are. I'm like, grandmother is my mother. Her firstborn is my mother, and the secondborn as well is my mother, and the other aunts. I'm actually confused who is my mother.
Yeah.
You know, the upbringing was so confusing and so tense and also very complex, yes. Yeah. Now, with that being said, you know, Alex is a very how do I put this? The ambience there is so exuberant, and a lot of things, you know, are compacted into it. But there are those that, you know, are prominent more than the others, you know. Wealth is pursued by many, and people flash their lives before others. You know, being a communal setup, you would know if they're eating eggs and you're actually eating tea and, you know, pap, you know.
Yeah.
So you would know if they're frying meat or frying meat and you would be eating pap, you know, with nothing. So Alex is like that. And even with the activities that go on there, you know, if people are going to school, you would see if there's a doctor, you would see, even though you would scarcely see professionals, but there are professionals that you see. But whatever it is that was dominant there was not something professional or positive.
Okay.
The criminal element was more prevalent than any other thing, you know. Yes. And, you know, growing up as a child, you play cops and robbers. And all the time when I'm watching this type of stories where there's a thief and a cop, you know, I'm more aligned to the villain side of things because I'm thinking these guys can do things, you know, without even being scared of these others. Also, the ambience in the township, it tells me that. Say, okay, you are here now and this is the situation you're facing in the house, you know, hunger, poverty, lack of this, lack of that. Now you can imagine if you are being raised by a grandmother, she's working as a maid, and as she's working as a maid, she can't really afford to, you know, give everyone, you know, the life that they need. Now, kuzofanele ngqoke ihembe lika the brother. You know, after he has worn it
for some time
and the shirt itself is ravaged or worn out, if you like, you know. Sometimes you told a good next door, sometimes you told a and told a good lie. We call a vitigi, scatulos, dabgil and a pansy. I put card boxes there, isogi, silly zamba. You're scraping for things and scraping for things as a young child. You cannot figure out a lot, you know, especially with your callow mind. You can't really do a lot, you know. So, I'm thinking, ish, how do I then, you know, juggle or maneuver through all of this, you know? And then obviously what you see around you and what you see as resolve around you will inspire you, you know? Before then, this brother of mine, who is my uncle, you know, and then he's taken away to his father's place and it's in the Eastern Cape. When he goes there, we are sala ungeni boarding school. My grandmother can do things for him, you know, since he's at bay and I'm here. I cannot see what she does for her and what she can do for me. And now things are starting to be scarce, you know, on my side. I actually don't receive much, you know, and actually don't receive anything because she has to send things. She has to pay people to actually take things to my brother and send food and da-da-da-da-da-da, you know, all those things that are actually, you know, involved with that, you know. So what we do is she goes back to work. She does sleep in my kitchen. Now I'm staying here in this mkuku and I'm alone and no one is there.
Nobody to monitor you.
Beggar, I'm 8 years old at the time and I'm staying in this mkuku. Okay, maybe going towards nine, but I'm staying alone and I'm still, you know, a minor at the time, like a minor.
Yeah.
You understand, yes. So now I'm here. You know, obviously she's going to tell the neighbor, Putin kelu pege u umtwana or Sis Helen or whoever, you know, look at the child, da-da-da-da-da-da. Yeah. So I'm actually, you know, alone.
Yeah.
And I have to actually fend for myself, you know, because it's either I go to this next door neighbor, I sit, I watch TV, and then I was raised to say, you don't wait. Abantu mabephaka. You actually get up and you get out. You understand? You don't actually eat emzini abantu and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But now I'm hungry.
Yeah.
You know, and I'm sitting
alone.
Here and I'm alone. And people buy a pag. And begukona your leftovers that came from Emakishini last weekend when Gogo visited when she was going to church. You understand? Now that has run out. Now what do I do?
Sure.
You know? So I cannot sit with these people. Okay, it's in your strategy, na machensa kona, you know, my peers who are actually also perhaps rebels or whatever, you know, but they living the same life that I'm living because there's scarcity at home and they're trying to hustle it out. I'm talking about children here, you know, zotlali zwipi, zotlala matais, there is a hostel around the Alexander, siatunyo, alapayana, and then we devised, okay, as in, let us go to these outlets. You know, where they're selling groceries and stuff like that. And we go to these outlets and we steal chocolate. Like chocolate was something that could be, you know, bought easily. Yes. Now we go, we steal chocolate, we come and sell. Some we eat, some we enjoy. And then we, 20 rand nyana, you can do something about it. You know, you go play your dice, you go to the bioscope where you know, movies are watched. And then we, you know, as a child, you think, okay, I've got this, you know, you go and steal, sometimes you steal bread and then you bring it at home and then you eat and then I'm alone and the door uses a chain to lock. At other times I forget, you know, at other times I'm with my, you know, other friend who I play with, he's here and he, and perhaps he's 12 years old and he smokes cigarettes.
Sure.
And when he smokes, I'm going to try, you know, the type of thing.
Because also you want to fit in because you don't even know.
You know what, that type of thing, yes. But I've never had that syndrome of trying to fit in.
Okay.
No. But I knew that I needed things. You know, I knew that I needed, you know, to advance in whatever thing that I was doing. Yes. But nevertheless, when this thought occupied my mind of, chocolate. It was a matter of me saying, okay, you know, and buy a shirt and buy pants. And then I go to school and I have no one laughing at me, you know, with my pants that were tried to be, you know, shrunk and then, you know, try to fit me. And then he comes closer and now it looks like eyes or whatever the case might be and whatever that people were laughing at, you know. Yes. And then, here I am, I'm hooked into this chocolate thing, and then I get arrested.
Sure.
You know, arrested, put in a cage. I'm a minor, I think I was nine. 9 years old. I'm put in a cage. I spent 14 hours in a cage. 14 hours at 11:15, ebusuku, I'm released and I'm given my chocolate. And then I have to walk from sundown because I think Dion was in sundown, closer to Brambley as well. So I had to walk from there to Alex at 11 p.m., you know, then I walked. When I get back, found my friends because that mkuku that was my home, you know, my friends would always come when they were told, hey, hamba buyala la ubuya khona. So they would come to me because I'm alone, you know. So they would stay with me. Now, when I get back there, they are celebrating me instead of, you know, them being worried that, hey, we could get arrested and da-da-da-da-da.
Instead of it being a lesson, it's, you like, you're the hero now.
Now I'm a hero because I even brought back the chocolate. So they let me go, I've got the chocolate, and then we ate that and then we slept. Tomorrow, we do the same thing. But it balloons now to other things. Now we start breaking into houses, white people's houses. You know how Alexander is surrounded by the suburban areas, mm-hmm. you know, all around it. Mm-hmm. So, sizosuka la ekhaya, sivaye siye eBrimley, sifike sizoshaya house breaking. Okay. And before then, we would just go to the parks, so thathela abantwana babelunga ama bicycle, and then come back. When we come back to the township. And in the township, we will get a buyer. You know, there are always stupid people stupid people that will buy stolen property. Mm-hmm. So what are they doing in essence? They're actually exacerbating the habits that we actually, because if you're going to give me 400 rands and I'm like 10 years old or 11 years old, and then I buy myself an All-Star, buy myself a jean and t-shirt, mm-hmm. then you as an adult, you have given me 400 rands. What are you telling me? You're telling me what I'm doing, it's okay. Yeah. You understand? So crime in its essence back then, it was actually nurtured, you know, around such, you know, measures where you go and steal, you come back and these people buy. Even when the police are looking for somebody who has done things, no one will tell, you know, this type of thing. Yeah. So it was exacerbated in that sense. Now what happened was we broke into these houses, we steal, we bring whatever things that we can get there, your gadgets and everything, and then we sell in the township. Mm-hmm. Now what we do is we sell, the only thing that we do, we buy clothing, and then you try to better your life. Mm-hmm. You know, you try to say, okay, I have no TV, I have no VHS, I mm-hmm. got to put that, I have no sound system, and then everybody starts seeing them cuckoo turns into mm-hmm. something else, you know. So everybody now thinks, yeah, he's doing well, I've got to find my own cuckoo and then live independently. Da, da, da. Everybody, you know, inspires somebody with doing something. We're thinking it's constructive and positive, and we are taking responsibility, you know, when in a sense we're actually dipping each other into a ditch, you understand, yes. But nonetheless, life flows, and then we're busy doing this. At some point, we get arrested. Mm. It was at night. We had broken at a house somewhere in the neighboring suburbs. Mm-hmm. We had broken into a house, stolen some goods. Whilst we were walking in this road, you know, we're trying to catch a taxi, whether it goes to town or it goes to Alex, we're going to catch any one of those mm-hmm. taxis, you know, just to be on the safe side. Yeah. And then we'll speak to the driver when we're already in the taxi. And like with the drivers as well, they allowed it. You mm-hmm. know, when you're in a taxi and you say, we're going to give you 200 rands. Back then, when a taxi was 230 so if
that's
I'm saying
a lot of money, you set him up for the day. Money,
you know, for the day, yes, for his checking, actually. Mm-hmm. So we would give him money and then he would, you know, take us to a lokshini, there's always stupid people who buy stolen goods, you know, But then again, this night, an unfortunate night, I should say, we have these bags and we're walking down this road. Now, this road has got outlets on this other side. It's got buildings and outlets on this other side and buildings. You know, there isn't any place to run to. Mm-hmm. Then we say, no, like, guys, let's just walk a little. Bese siyomala pe bus stop nalezinto lezi. They say sivaye kakhulu. We understand. I ask blooming la. Sizomela iteksi mayidlula. Okay, fine. We stop at a bus stop. Somebody says, nah, let's pick the bags. Mm-hmm. Just when we are moving, there are two people in front of us, you know, pretending to be boyfriend and girlfriend. Mm-hmm. And then there are a group of people who are also inebriated or seemingly inebriated. They are coming from behind. We're mm-hmm. thinking, or oh, these people are coming from a, you know, club somewhere.
They're minding their business.
You know, minding their own business. Yeah. And then we're seeing the others on the other side of the street. Like, you're thinking, okay, it's like this, you know, in the suburbs at night, people are having it, you know, nice and da-da-da. But we're walking and walking and walking, walking, and there's no taxi that is coming. Mm-hmm. But at a point when we put the things down and say, now, let's stop here mm-hmm. and see whatever car comes or taxi that comes and then or maxi taxis by then, we're thinking we're going to catch that. Mm. Unfortunately, when we just put the bags down, these guys, they turn and they pull guns. This is a woman and a man. Mm-hmm. They turn and they pull guns. When you start stepping back and trying to, mm-hmm. They're like, they've cornered us here. Mm. And on this side, there's a building. You cannot even go over a wall or anything of mm-hmm. that sort. So you were just cornered there. And then they apprehended us, arrested us. We were four, taken two into one van. I think at the time I was 15 or 16, between that age. Now they take two into other van, and then they take the other two into another van.
Were these people like your community policing forum or something like that?
No. These were police.
Police, okay.
You know, going incognito without uniforms. Okay. You know how it is.
Yeah.
Because what happened was at the house when we were breaking in, it was an elderly couple, mm-hmm. so there was a panic button, and we knew nothing about a panic button back then.
Yeah.
So it had actually alerted the securities, the mm-hmm. police, and they waited until we took whatever we wanted to take, and then get out and then walk the streets so that they pound on us like mm-hmm. red-handed mm-hmm. with evidence and everything like yeah. that. Yes. But we were taken to another police station. At that police station, they said, no, these people stay in Alexandra, so take them to Weinberg police station, and then that's where we were locked in. Mm-hmm. Okay, fast forward. Now we're in jail. We went to court. We got a remand. And then we went to Sun City. Mm. I understand. So, Masese Sun City, we come back 7 days later to the court. Mm. When we're attending, they grant us all bails. Manje mabakunike bail ye 3,000.
You must pay it.
And you need to pay 3,000. And you don't have the money. Because
sure.
whatever we get, whatever we do, we use the yeah. money. And unwisely so, because we actually know nothing about managing finances and stuff, mm-hmm. you know, yes. So the others got bailed. And then two are bailed by their parents. Obviously, they are well-moneyed and everything mm-hmm. like that. These are just people who suffer from peer pressure and mm. everything, but at home, you know, they can afford and all of that.
Yeah.
Now it's two of us remaining. The other one, the next day, they come and bail him out from jail in Sun City.
Mm.
When my grandmother came, it was approximately a month later when I had already went to court again and asked for the reduction of the, you know, the bail money.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then she came. And then she bailed me. Hey, sengibashi lenginjani laphayana. The complexion, if you know jail, they actually house you there. And when you're awaiting trial, you, unlike the people who are convicted and sentenced, mm-hmm. you actually remain indoors all the time. The okay. only time you get out, it's when you're going to get your food. And then you mm-hmm. come back to the cell and you're locked up, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, so upuma lapi complexion ya kanya. I don't know where you're coming from.
We are glower.
You understand. But in a very like obvious way that, hey, this one doesn't look like, you know, any like normal people living outside.
Yeah.
There's something awkward about him, you know, especially in a sense that you don't have that glow that says, hey, this person is alive, you know. Yeah, it's sort of like you're coming from a morgue or something.
Yes.
You know, yeah, it's crazy. Not to see when you over when a move it or whatever the case might have been. So umakoko yang tata siyadlini. In fact, umakoko yenubuyele emsebenzini. I mean, I had to board a taxi on my own and then go back to Alex.
Mm-hmm.
Where I get off, nazi impinches up. Lesbian boshwe nazi. Eh, mfwetu. Grand high spirit. Okay, my grandmother had called me Kesna, so it also became the street name.
Okay.
So everybody, hey, Kesna, so buyile hancha, ungawari, hey, izolo sibuye kobashaya, bambanali jacket.
Mm-hmm.
I wanna like, they give you a leather jacket, mm-hmm. and they give you a sports shoe. It's your welcome,
yeah.
You know, yes. And then Nyangena, you obviously have your key because it's almost like your place, it's their den,
mm-hmm.
you know, where they actually do whatever they want to do freely. Now, bangena siyabhema. At the time, we're already using drugs,
okay.
like your Mandrax, like your weed. Those were the strong drugs that we were using at the time. So siyafika siyabhema siyabhema. At the same time, but matota sekumele siye rounding.
Okay.
And this is today.
You just came back today. Yeah.
Yes. So today, in the afternoons, I'm going back housebreaking again and theft, and then we get the money. I come back. This habit grows because here we were, we got arrested, and then I spent approximately a month, others spent a few days, and then they were out, and then the case was also dropped, and then the elderly people didn't want to follow up on that, mm-hmm. you know, the tedious process of going to and fro a court and all of that. So here we are thinking, okay,
you can actually get away with it.
And nalama, you know, jail has got a different setup.
Mm-hmm.
And then it tells you, okay, if you are going to get into jail and you have done this crime or you're this young, this is how the other inmates are going to treat you.
Mm-hmm.
So you actually need to, you know, level up, get on other higher sure. levels so that if it happens that you get arrested, then you know kuthi nawo uzobukulapha kulama echelons ngena athile lawo sizcreate lawona as criminals. Yes. So now, I graduate, housebreaking becomes house robbery, mm-hmm. because now that becomes the play, the things are now difficult. You know, mm-hmm. you can't go. Walls are getting higher. There's electric fence. There's cameras. There's panic button. There's all sorts of security beams now. And everything like that. Mm-hmm. You know, now when you try to, you know, evade all of that, you've got to advance.
Yeah.
Masiago housebreaking, or before the housebreaking, I think I got a gun mangina. Maybe being in a 10 or 11. Mm. Yeah, mangtolikan.
Sure.
And because I said NMP, nyana, nkata, business, whatever, comrades, and da-da-da. So, ngatolikan, ngaychaf, gave it to my elder brother, and I wife, came back from boarding school, mina naye, we did things together, you know, but ikan, besi, seven samasyo, kwachisa banya band, you know, that type of thing, yes.
Yeah.
So, here I am, still living alone. And now I'm advancing with crime. Now I'm starting house robberies. Now I'm starting to see, I need to go and stay somewhere. Njengabanyabantu. Remember, I'm still a teen.
Sure.
Understand. And I'm still going to school, by the way. Mm-hmm. So at this point, the rate enghamba ngayo, I'm no longer looking back.
Sure.
Like there is nothing that says to my cognitive,
pause a bit.
You know, says, hey, my guy, relax now. Nah. It's like the adrenaline actually pumps, you know, even further, saying, hey, go on, you find what you want, you know, go on, you get on what you want. And then I'll just cut to and drugs so popular and in the people you are moving with, they're actually called by your name. I want Abo Madam Speaker. I Abo cares now. You know, when it's about four people, but they are called by your name, you know, that type of thing. Yes. So now when you become that phenomenon, now
you
must know there's no turning back and there is no retreat for you or surrender. Because here you are, you think you are leading people, you know, you are assuming that leadership because everybody's called by your name.
Yeah.
Now, when you look back to say, if I would, you know, recant or, refocus my mind to something positive, you're thinking, ay, ngizobay parila.
Yes.
Ngono man ngiqhubeke nale, la ngiyawoshipa, la bayang onara yonke leyanto leyana, everybody respects me. It's the streets, you know, that's how it is. So we've broken somewhere. The police come to school whilst I'm writing an exam. And they pick me up.
Sure.
At school.
In the middle of an exam.
Like everybody in Gena night class who lapo. Abandona beskolo ba lapo. And the police, they pick me up there.
Sure.
And I get arrested lapo. Imagine the shame. Imagine the whatever thing that it brings, you know.
Yeah.
And then I go ngiyaphuma, ngiyabuya futhi, I'm trying to focus esikolweni, but now there's a stigma. You've been to prison. You're a tsotsi, whatever you have, you know, it's because of the criminal activities that you do. Now obviously I'm not longer, you know, gonna focus on school like I used to.
You will want to live up to what people
have already.
Because
I had kept this habit secret, you know, especially at school.
Yeah.
Whatever you would know about me outside of the school premises, that was fine. But now it has exposed me here where I thought, you know, this is my solace place or a place of solace for me. So it was a crazy setup like that. Now I get out of school. This is grade 10 going to grade 11. I actually didn't go to grade 11, even though I passed. But I said, no. I'm quitting school. I'm driving a car.
Going to the school of life now.
Yeah, I'm driving a car. I've got jewelry. I've got a place to stay. I've got a house. So these are the things that people go to school for.
Yeah.
So I got them even before I go to, you know, higher learning universities and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm thinking, I'm the man, you know. I'm even selling drugs. I'm doing robberies. I'm doing this. I'm also hijacking cars.
Mm-hmm.
One day I got to this, you know, with other guys. And then we were hijacking.
Mm-hmm.
And then I get arrested. And then I get 15 years.
Sure.
Then 15 years, this is my first time getting in jail.
Yeah.
Like in Kwej, because a life in Kwej, you got two. I'm a maximum sentences.
Okay.
So at this time, it was the first time in Kwecho, bang nigezo 15 years.
Mm.
So they give me 15 years. And then, kulo 15 years, I did an appeal. And then after this appeal, ngisala ngo 13 years.
Mm-hmm.
And then 13 years, I had to serve 6.5 years.
Okay.
Now, when you get into prison, and you don't know anything about the other side.
Yeah.
You know, you would know awaiting trial.
Yeah.
You don't know the other side where people are convicted and sentenced. It's much scary.
Sure.
It's scarier than you can imagine, you know. I know perhaps you've heard people speak about jail and the gruesomeness of it. Mm. Like when you get into the place where, you know, the admission process goes on, it's quiet. Like, it's like, you know, nothing goes on. But
you're not in the jungle yet.
You know, once you are through that process
and
now you're going to the other side. Wow. You just hear with the, you know, the bedlam of noise, and then people are screaming, and those who know you and those who don't know you. And there are, you know, there are people who are looking at you, salivating to say, yo,
fresh meat is here now.
You know, that type of thing. And in that instance, I was arrested alone. The others who were with me actually managed to escape. And then mina ngangena ngiyiwani. So I had to stand for indaba yami. You understand? So went into prison. Mangingena. I only stayed there, I think, approximately 2 months. Not even 2 months, but a month and a couple of days, you know. P3. P3, it's a project. It's a Sun City. It's called Medium Beats, also called P3. Mm-hmm. It houses adults, you know. So me getting in there, I was also moved because, no, I actually belonged to a... the juvenile center, because I wasn't, you know, still under 21 at the time. So I had to go to another project, which is P1.
Okay.
So at P1, Maufiga, we are admitted, you stay in a single cell, you know, single cell, but you're not alone. You're actually sharing with somebody. Okay. It's a small space, like really small space, but there's a bank, a bottom bank and a, you know, top bank. Yeah. Yes. And then you sleep. When we are figure obvious, so tolo munye sega occupy the bottom bank, which is not even tedious to climb and get off, you know. And then when I go to bambale pezul, until perhaps they move or something happens,
then
and then
occupy
you
the
know,
bottom.
You, yeah. So it's that kind of setup. Now when I'm there, I used to go to church, you know. Growing up, my grandmother Begum St. John's, you know, she went, you know, she took us to church. And we would run away again, Masisa Church. By church, I can get on 11. Your shy is 4:30. So we had a problem with that. Man, just sag was no way and I said by scope. Everyone, any by scope, again around 11:30. No, no, no. And then when we went there, see two, Nale, brother Yam, Maupumekala. You would have won because lo sala mela sale, because grandmother has to see that one of us is still there, you know. So that's how we actually did it. And then eventually grandmother yabona labantu abalithandile sonto la. And then she says, guys, please go to church.
Any church of
your choice. And then we go to the Roman Catholic, because obviously the Roman Catholic, they only spend an hour and a half or two. We mass yabo, and then it's out.
Yeah.
And then puma ke, and then we joined that. So I used to go to church, you know. Noma ngiyakuphi banginvite kuphi, I used to go to church. Okay. So when I'm in jail, I read the Bible. There were these smaller Bibles. They had the Book of Psalms, and they also had the New Testament. Okay. You know, they were brought to prison by Hope Ministries, I think. So I would constantly read this. Now there are also, you know, when they're singing, they're singing about Namhlanje Sabbath, and then I'm reading something else here. And then for me, it was a bit of a confusion, you know. Yeah. And then I'm like, Sunday, Sabbath, which one is it?
Yeah.
You know, the seventh day, which one is it? You know, I'm puzzled. Then I go to the library. When I go there, I'm checking everything from a lexicon to encyclopedia to all books, just trying to figure out what's the difference between the 2 days.
Yeah.
And then I finally came to a conclusion that, okay, the seventh day is the Sabbath, which is a Saturday in modern times, you know. And then, okay, so the first day is Sunday.
Yeah.
Then now I'm intrigued to find out, how did it come about that now this one is kept holy instead of the holy one, you know, the one that from creation God actually sanctified, put apart, and, you know, blessed and everything like that.
Yes.
So now, this intrigues my fancy. I started, you know, pursuing this. Now that it actually opened up doors for me to actually study almost every religion, you know, with your Krishna, the Hindu, with your
Buddha
with your Muhammad and the Islam, Rastafarian and many others, because I explored a lot of religions. I think it's way above 50 religions that I actually read about.
Yeah.
And then I went and prayed with Muslims just to get the feel of it. And then I couldn't grasp anything that says, hey, I'm here, or invigorated me inside and you know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But I went to gather with the Rastafarians because they kept the Sabbath, but they smoked weed and they beat up drums. And they always spoke about Haile Selassie. And then I'm like, nah. And
so
they,
that means
they, you know, their principal, I think, man after God, or their Messiah in a sense, because that's how they interpret it. So all these religions, they had that. But for me, I couldn't actually fathom what was it, you know, actually that matters with these people, that they have the middle people or the mediators between God and man. I couldn't actually, you know, actually fully fathom whether it makes sense or not.
Yeah.
So this research actually grew and grew and grew and grew and grew. But all the time I was bothered because Jesus had said he's the mediator between men, and then him being begotten without the Father and the without the Father, without the Father, and actually without the Father and the Mother doing the deed, you know. Yes. So that on its own, it was a miracle thing. And God speaking out creation, it was also a miracle thing, you know. So for me, the birth of Christ and the creation of the world had a resonance of some sort. Now I must, you know, it said to me, now you must explore this avenue. You must actually research here. Whilst I was busy with that, I would find all faults, all sorts of faults about other religions, you know, or critics or the positive stuffs and da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da, because I wasn't a fully-fledged Christian, because I was still also puzzled, you know. Yes. Now, there come other people who are visiting, because people visit prison. So Guzalabantu bazoyenza church and they come on a Saturday.
Okay.
And these people, they come and they preach, you know. They preach from Genesis to Revelation and showing the importance of the Sabbath. And these people are Seventh-day Adventists, but I didn't know by then, you know. And they gave us, you know, lessons and verses, and they were interpreting scripture with scripture without using perhaps anything, could be their doctrine or anything. They never used that. They just stuck on the Bible.
Okay.
Now, this is where everything else with God caught me.
Okay.
You know, that's where I became a Christian, a godly man, because these people were talking about this. They gave me a booklet. It's called Step to Christ. And then I read chapter 3 on that booklet, and it spoke of repentance. And it doesn't just speak of repentance on the surface. It actually delves in deeper to a point where you see yourself as almost the most sinful of them, of all people, because it says you repent inwardly and even outwardly. It should show, whatever it's in there should reflect on the outside. So this is when I picked this up. But being immature in the spirit world, you know, you cannot grasp everything fully at that time. So I have this movement that now, or a denomination that I'm now, you know, found this Sabbath keeping people. I'm no longer confused about that. I'm now exploring their doctrine, now trying to find out, do they have a mediator like the others? No, they don't. You know, Christ, the Bible, and they are sola scriptura. I think this is Italian for the Bible and the Bible alone.
Okay.
You know, yes. So I'm content with that.
So you could resonate with that.
You understand. Okay. So I moved with them. But now, sisikhathi siyafika ngiyaphuma manje ngiyangaphandle.
Hey, problems now.
So mangihamba ngisuka elentuzane, mangisuka ejele. I had, you know, I had hope ukuthi when I get outside I'll do better, because I was someone who read a lot. Even though I didn't do school, but there were courses that I did, your end courses and da 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 da, you know, just to try and equip yourself, yes. So I'm telling myself I'm empowered and I'm ready to live a positive life, you know. But when I get home, mangifika endlini, loya bhuti wami loya, umalume wami lo bhuti wami, is dead. And he died, actually, mina ngisentenzwa ngo-August, yena he dies in December.
Sure.
He's dead. My grandmother is alone. My mother and my grandmother, the relationship has never actually been anything, you know. Yeah, so just like it has never been anything with me and her. So ukuthi kuphi akekho, it actually doesn't, it matters, but it doesn't matter. I don't know if that oxymoron makes sense. Yeah. But yeah, it is an oxymoron, but it makes sense to me. You know, yes, she is and she's not. We you know, I'm taking it like that. Now, nakuke, mawufika endlini, abantu sebashaya ngamaplasma. And I mean, ejele, I had a friend, Italian friend, who was married to this Africana lady. She was just a good guy. He became a father figure, seeing me, visiting me. I actually met him at Brembly, Aboshiwe. You know, he was arrested. He was a friend of mine. So he was taking care of me even in jail. You know, he tried, even though I sold weed and did that in jail, but he always, you know, made sure that each month or twice a month he would be there, you know, to come and see me and bring whatever he can bring for me. PJs, underwears, you know, the type of things, yes. Now, ngulo muntu lo, he says to me, if ungakwazi obtain a license, I'm going to give you a car and see where we can fit you in my projects.
Okay.
You know, he does a lot of engineering projects and he's willing to actually, you know, tune me in. Okay, fine. For me, I shouldn't have a license. It's a 30 stretch.
Yeah,
I understand. That's what I'm thinking. Because when I got home, I was exposed to gwindlala. Like I left it before.
Yes.
You know?
Things are exactly the way you left them.
Yeah, like a room divider. When people are using stands for television.
Yeah.
You know, a room divider. Nalea TV liana, there's a DVD on top of it. Because of whatever particulars are in the DVD and the TV, now the color of the TV, the screen changes. And even the colors are rainbow. And then even when you're watching it, there's this, you know, dent that actually dents the whole picture. It's crazy. Then when you get back there and you're like, hey, I'm changed. But how am I going to fix this? Because now I'm a grown up, you know. I'm no longer, but now I'm a young adult and I need to fend for myself. Because
the same
my grandmother,
way you've been doing.
You know?
Yeah.
So it's like, even before then, Ngizobosh, me and no brother Wam had spoken to say, we cannot both be doing crime. And then we spoke. You're going to go to school or I'm going to school, you know? And I'm saying, you go to school.
Yeah.
I'll take care of you. This is me telling him, you know, But yeah, unfortunately, he died.
How did he die?
He got sick,
You
know. Yeah, he was also signed.
Crime-related?
No.
Okay.
He was a very good soccer player.
Okay.
He was also, you know, at the time, got a contract with the Tembisa Classic, and Tembisa Classic would have actually made him prominent because he was very good playing soccer. You know, you don't get nicknames like Maradona.
Yeah.
And you just a Parcela and you know, he was
you
very
must be
good.
Really good.
Yeah, he was really good. So he got that contract. So things were promising, but he got a contract today. In 3 days' time, he dies.
Whew.
So his stomach cramp. When he's in an ambulance being taken to hospital, on the way, he's declared dead. And then that's it, you know. So I hear this, I'm devastated. I didn't even come to, you know, lay him to rest and da-da-da-da-da-da. So I'm coming out, they come back into my head. I'm thinking, lo meleng menzeli tombstone. And then there was this other, the little sister to my mother. When again, she died earlier, you know, she also got sick. That's the crazy part. Everybody gets sick and they die. So she also died. So because I was so attached to these two people, you know, my thing was I need to do something for them because I actually never really enjoyed life with them. So mang totally situation in poverty. The mother has brought my mother now, like biological mother. He's like her child. My little brother is here and another is here. My two sons are there, you know. So I had to make a plan.
To what you've been doing the whole time, your whole life, which is making sure that ends meet.
You understand? So I'm a father to two boys. So I had to, you know, make means that my boys are actually catered for.
Yeah.
So my grandmother as well, she's a pensioner. What would a pensioner, like pensioner do with such a crowd? You know, she wouldn't get far, you know.
Yeah.
It will be the same, you know, rat race.
Yeah.
Poverty, try, you know. It was crazy for me. So I saw, okay, I guess it's true. We live by the gun, we die by the gun.
Yeah.
You know, you get rich or you die trying. You know, those codes, they actually made sense back then, mm-hmm. you know, because, yeah, obviously this was now the dominant thing in my head, you know. So I fed that dog, okay. and then I went back to crime. Sure. Now, kumbula manga pagat, ngihlangana negebengu. Eziyenza kakhulu ngaphandle. Mina ngiboshwela ama-hijacking, bengenza ama-house robbery, ama-house breaking and theft. Mm-hmm. These people do cash in transit heist, business robberies. And
abo scheme GP lab.
Yeah, and they tell me about these people. Yeah. You know, so abanye abafana abahlala ekhaya yakho scheme GP. Intwana mani nakimi, mangithi ngiyabheka ngithi abafana laba banawo lo mlilo lo nginawo. Le plug name inenginayo. Noma abantu bayazenza lezi zinto, mara angeke ba. You understand? Sure. So that thing, when I'm outside, it comes back.
Yeah.
It says to me, hey, when?
It resurrects that thing.
You like understand? It's revival. Whether in your tando or angtan.
Sure.
And then quickly, you know, Satan, Satan ungayindlela. He puts things into place. Yeah. You understand? Very quick. But when you are thinking of doing something right, Satan also put things into place to stymie that, mm-hmm. because he doesn't want that type of progress in a person, especially law or claim aguti Christ is my savior. Yeah. He'll always put things, you know, to hinder really, you know, to stumble, you know, that type of thing. Yes, like he makes sure that you've got stumbling blocks before you, not just small anyana hurdles that you would run and jump over. No. He puts high holes, like you need to climb, you know, summit a mountain. And when you finish summiting that, you see another. Mm-hmm. And that's Satan putting another hurdle before you. So, there are things in place, you know. And then I meet that guy who I was with in jail. And then he says to me, hey, I know this other guy, you know. Yeah, how many guns have you got? And I've already started, you know, with what I know. House breaking, house robberies and hijacking, trying to do whatever thing I can do. Now I've already got two firearms, and then I'm meeting this guy, and then we go together. He tells me about his two Zimbabwean friends he met, and then we form a gang.
Sure.
And then we hit hard because, you know, we are a crew. We can do our things,
C4.
Yeah. And then we can also go magune ipane ezinkulu where we need 17 men to, you know.
So what type of crime are you now doing?
Now I'm doing cash in transit heist, and I'm doing business robberies. Okay. House robbery is more like when I'm doing nothing. Mm. Because manje, angisakwazi ukuhlala nje. You understand that
I'm
money orientated, and I want to see myself counting additional money, not the money I have in the house.
That's where you do
it. Yeah, like a peace job, house robber. It becomes now an easier job for me, you know, because like Zoglinda, you come in with your car and then I get in with you and it's Bamba. Or we just come in and then you just open your door and then Siangena and then, you know, that type of thing. Or at night and then it grew up. Lento ya bamba, wana lama cash in transit heist, business robberies. One point, I want to tell you a story about the wounds. So you were like, and then this guy, you know, with these obvious disfigurements, if I may put it that way.
Because I can see a scar here and also on the head. Yeah, there's a
big scar and the amputation here.
Yes.
So one night I'm at home, like where I lived with this girlfriend that I had back then, you know. And then I receive a call. Hey, my guy, how are you? I'm like, okay, I'm fine. Then, man, we need you. Mm-hmm. You know, we need to go somewhere in the Free State. Oh, okay, no problem. So what's the job? And then they tell me about millions. Once you talk millions, and then I'm like, yo, I'm into the whole, like, fans, we are in a five nyana. You know, that type of thing, yes.
You're going to be set for a while.
Yeah, you know, not set for a while. I'm not... Like how I used to do these things. I wasn't one to say, hey, I'm set.
Mm-hmm.
Once I got this yesterday, that's yesterday's story.
Today
there has to be another story. The only time I got, you know, to chill a bit, Friday evening, because I'm observing the Sabbath until Sabbath evening.
Mm-hmm.
And then from Sabbath evening up until the other day, Mshito
Zolapi. Sure.
And that was crazy.
Mm.
That, be that as it may, these people call me and then I respond to their call and then they don't have a car.
Mm-hmm.
Like we used to have stolen or robbed cars, you know, that we keep.
Mm-hmm.
But that night, for some reason, two cars were in the Free State and we're supposed to go in the Free State. So we couldn't actually go and fetch those stolen cars in the Free State and then come back and then organize other people. I just had to take my own car, and then we drove with my car. And then on our way driving, there's this place, you know, it's a busy place. We know we pass by that place all the time, it's busy, but we've never actually, you know, you know, just shake them a little. Like, hey, my guy, now I'm going to snacks. Loud is going to start any warm up. So, figure, I'm going to go food to my little chimney. And then here we were, get into this place, and then we rob that place. And we take whatever we can take. You know, this was a minor thing to do, actually. You know, we rob, and then we get into a car. And then this is a straight car. The only thing I did was just to took out the number plate at the back, because the frontal one was just, you know, going to pass by the door. So the people who were going to come out after we have done this, they were going to be able to see the other one. Yes, so just pull out that one when we stopped. And then we entered the store. And then Satata Logosuk Tata and Emalia Corner. And we got into the car. On the way, Safiga Savula is up Hoover, you know, put everything intact, the money in the subwoofer, the guns and everything, and then we stayed with the snacks, and then we ate, and then we drove. Whilst driving, sees the siren and thinking the police are going to come this way, we decide, guys, let's take another route. And le route sitata, it's not your freeway that is, you know, your renovations are conducted at all times, you know, it's taken care of. We're using an old way. Now we're taking this way, I don't know this way, no street lights, no nothing, no markings on the ground and everything like that. So ngapa I'm pedaling and I'm thinking, hey, we don't want anybody, like, you know, to be following us. You know, we're in panic. We're thinking it could be the police. You know, yes, Oguti, I cannot tell you to this day what happened, how it happened, I don't know. But I just know I hit a ditch, whether it was deep or a pothole.
Okay.
And then the car flew and it was turning. And then when it landed, you know, I'm on the driver's seat.
Yeah.
When it landed, my hand was here. And obviously the other was there. You know almost how we like to. Actually, the mic when I'm gesticulating is disturbing me. But I hope you can hear me when I'm speaking from this angle. So now, when it landed, it lands with this side.
Okay.
And I'm holding there, you know, and the steering wheel.
With that, yeah.
Now, because the car is falling, I'm actually finding balance when I'm holding like that.
Sure.
So the car screeching from here to there on the tar, that's when the fingers were chopped off. And some part of the car got in here, some other part of the car. I was shot here before in another job, but there was something that pierced right on top of where I was shot before, you know, like that. So those are the injuries I sustained that night. Now, when I woke up, on the side of the road, there's this white man. He's on a cell phone. And I'm on a lap of one of the guys. It's actually the three of us. You know, I'm on a lap and I'm like, hey, why nega lenga amni mela? That gunman bambe lenga amna satin lekara sambin. This is me. And that's how demon possessed I was with criminal
even when
activities.
You were injured.
Like, I'm injured. I need help. The guy is on the side of the road calling for an ambulance.
And you're thinking,
and
of
I'm saying
of
to these
him.
Guys, hey, let us just take this guy and, you know, take his phone, take his money, take the keys, and let's take his car. You guys will drop me off at, you know, at a hospital, and then you guys can succeed with the other things. But the guys weren't buying it. And then I tell the other one, go and unscrew the subwoofer, take out the firearms. What if, you know, police would come and attend the scene and everything like that? Now, that's how bad, you know, I was deep into that I was. You know, so you would sit now in a prison and try and cogitate about all these things. This is where you see, no, he couldn't have been a human being. You know, there was some energy that was actually driving me. You know, I was a vessel being used. But we cannot hide behind that as well because we decide to be used. Yeah. Because even if you are a vessel, the power behind the vessel speaks to the vessel, whether you want or you don't. Yeah. You understand? So, nevertheless, this one gets up. And then he leaves me sitting on the tar. And then he goes and unscrew. And then after taking everything, they don't want to stand. They're like, yeah, we're coming. We're seeking for help there. Yeah. And then they go.
With all the things.
They run away.
You were left there alone.
And then I'm left there alone with this white guy, whom I don't know to this day.
Whom you wanted to rob.
whom I wanted to rob. Sure. And the guy waits. An ambulance arrives. Mm. The guy actually is on a convoy with the ambulance. When he gets to the hospital, he says, I don't want to sign anything. I just wanted to see him in a hospital. That's it. And then the guy leaves. Sure. To this day, if I tell you, Madam Speaker, I still want that guy.
Yeah.
And I know this guy, it's going to be difficult to find him.
Yeah.
You know, he's like every other victim of a crime like South Africa.
Mm-hmm.
I still want to find, I know I cannot find those whom I've harmed, but ngiyakwazi ukuthi mangithola platform efana nale and say, Madam Speaker, you know, at this moment, let me still this minute and say, you know, to every victim a crime in South Africa, I apologize.
Sure.
First me, and then on behalf of, you know, the other perpetrators.
Yeah.
Either who are in jail and the others who are still going to do these things because, hey, it's not stopping. We are fighting this and it's not ending. You know,
circumstances at home.
You know, no, not even that. That's an excuse, actually. Yeah. You know, minds are getting out of hand. You know, the moral fabric is being ravaged and then no one actually takes into cognizance seriously as to what is harm and what is perpetrating, what is, you know, nobody actually thinks before they act, especially when they're doing evil things, you know. So, our mind, like, I can only say, ngiyaxolisa.
Yeah.
Yabona, kuwo wonke umuntu engenga ngamhama. I know, obviously, my victims are all white.
Yeah.
You know, but it affected across the racial spectrum because minang influence le, ngi influence le, and others took it up and they did it on everybody else.
Yeah.
And it wasn't even right if I was doing it kubantu abamhlophe or
abamnyama.
Yeah. But I extend that apology sincerely so to every victim of a crime because we experience that on a daily basis. And I family ngakho affected crime. That's why we have high walls, we have trackers, we have that, you know.
You know, I really appreciate you actually doing your part, you know, because for some people it's a matter of, I did the crime, I went to jail for it, so I don't need to apologize to anybody for that.
Yeah.
You know, so the impact of crime, it's really the reason why we're in this crisis that we're in as a country.
Absolutely.
It's because of the crime. And for you to come forward and say, listen, for my contribution and together with everybody else who has contributed in the crime in the country, I apologize. That is so deep and it's so humbling, you know. And I hope that everybody receives it the way that I'm receiving it from where I'm sitting.
Yeah, and Madam Speaker, people are not coerced to actually receive the apology.
Yes.
You know, people have been harmed and people are traumatized as we speak, you know. So people should take their time, find it in your heart to say, I can really forgive someone who has done me wrong, you know. We have been done wrong, you know, by families, by this and that and that and that. When we have tried and it took us time, some of us years, you know, some of us go to the grave without even thinking kutunga kolelu munyu muntu. You understand? So you can't blame people for not forgiving you.
Yeah.
Remember, these people were harmed. And umuntu hamiwe, no hamayo. The one that forgets easily is the one that harms. And the other one who was harmed can never really forget.
True.
So I'm not actually asking them to forget, but I want them to, you know, find it in their heart to forgive. You know, other people have done gruesome things. Abantu babulele abantu for no reason. So yeah, let us not prolong this further, but it comes from the heart.
Yeah, no, I appreciate that. Also, a big shout out to Pastor Bay there for giving us extra time. Because I could see where you can tell, hey, this one needs some extra time. But I would really love for us in closing, right?
Yeah.
To get to the, just on the conclusion side of this story that you're sharing with us today.
Yeah.
What was that wake up call for you to be the man that you are sitting, that you are here today?
Okay. I don't know how long I have, but after the injuries, I went to hospital and I asked a doctor to actually discharge me. He did without prescription. Obviously, I just got little medication wherever I could get it and then went out and then sourced my own painkillers, you know. A day after coming from the hospital, ngilimala ngei 12 zaka March. Nya house wa esibhedlela up until ngei 25 zaka March. Ngei 26 zaka March, seng sendlini ntambama ngiyavuka futhi I'm on a robbing spree.
Ha.
And I my footsteps, I told last footstep.
Mm-hmm.
And I've got a limp because a skin graft was performed. Kusho ukuthi bakhipha inyama la just to patch this exposed bone. Now I'm busy, you know, with robberies.
Sure.
Imagine the injuries. Mm. You know, it could be about 70 stitches that were here trying to, you know, put everything together. Yeah. It could be so much of the stitches there and then the skin graft. Mm. Anybody who has done or undergone skin graft will tell you, yo, Leontole, you can't stand the pain.
Yeah.
You know, so I'm limping like almost like a toddler. And then ngiyabanjwa ngelanga les 10 after, you know, I said I got out on the 25th. 26th, I'm beginning with my robbery. On the 6th of April, ngiyaboshwa.
While you're still not even healed from the injuries.
I haven't even begun thinking about healing at the time. So ngiyaboshwa ngene jele. The first thing that I do when I get into the police station, I kneel down. Now, the police station setup, it's divided into two. There's an inner cell and there's an outside court, but it's a cell altogether. So I kneel in this outer court. I, like, you know, irregardless of who is watching, listening, I don't care at that time. And then I tell God, if you take me out, and the prayer doesn't start by Father God, Jesus, nah, it says, if you take me out from this mess, I will never do crime again. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Mm.
You know, and that's the prayer I prayed. Now, God never wanted to, or he actually answered the prayer, but he had to refine the diamond. You know, I had to discard the scales. So I stayed 12 years because I was given 62 years from the crime that I committed when I was arrested.
Mm.
One guy died in that crime. The other one was shot in the leg. And then I was given 62 years. And then I managed to appeal that 62 years. And then it was reduced to 18. Remember, there was another sentence. So there was a parole remaining. Mm. Putting that together, when they fuse it, it was 24. I had to, you know, do half of that, which is 12 years. So the refinement process, it took about 12 years.
Sure.
So God just took me to a school where I will read. Because me studying the Bible, it actually allowed me to explore, you know, so many subjects. We could sit here, me and you, and discuss engineering. I would have a contribution.
Sure.
Maybe your acumen might be, you know, higher than mine, but I would have a contribution. Somebody might come and say astronomy. You know, my contribution would be there, but maybe the acumen. Even sometimes you find that I would reason even, you know, than the people who actually know the field, you know, better than them in a sense. Not necessarily me being better. No, I'm not being pompous about it, but I'm just showing you that from the study of the Bible for 12 years, that training up actually allowed me to explore, you know, other avenues of life and subjects and everything like that. So this is where the real transformation. Remember the grasping of God was when I grasped God, got out, but still juxtaposed, or should I say put together God and my crimes, you know, and perform whatever. I was still godly, but I also mingled that with error, you know, so which was crazy. But this time around, I'm 1 year, 11 months and 29 days, if I'm unmistaken, out here now, you know, going closer to 2 years. And I'm certain, because there are times when temptation is there, but do I heed to temptation? No, I just ignite a fruit of a spirit, you know, one of them, which is long-suffering, patience, and self-control. And then I, you know, each time I'm, now because I'm in Christ, each time temptation comes, I'm saying it's written, because I have to recall what's written for me to actually stand. That's why Christ would say, I'll never give you a burden that you cannot carry, you know. So I think basically to respond to your question is that, the godly aspect was more trained and more, you know, molded now. I was in the potter's hands in these 12 years. And perhaps all my life was my own wilderness journey, you know, and then the accident perhaps being my Damascus moment, and then the 12 years being my training up. But now I'm truly reformed. And what I do, I speak to children at school voluntarily.
Yeah.
Though sometimes I feel, hey, sebang exhausted kakhulu labantu,
because it gets overwhelming sometimes.
Yeah, it's overwhelming for me because I do it nge passion ngokuthanda abantwana. Oh, one other aspect, I don't know how much time we have, but mangisejela umntwana muyafo i1.
Sure.
ne mangisejele we are shown ngiyeza ngizomncwaba in shackles when I come to bury them. Imagine the shame, the humiliation that I'm giving to the other child and the family at large. You know, usiboshwa uzongcwaba umntwana. You actually bringing things kulabantu, and somehow there's a stigma or spotlight that you leave them with because abantu bangani bakhe bayazi ukuthi baba ke ibhanti.
Yeah,
you understand? Yes. So with the other child, ngihlala naye only 12 months. Last year, angithi kushona one ngisejele. I go back, mangiqeda kumncwaba, mangiphuma, ngisele nalo. Mangisele nalo, lo hla ngihlala naye 12 months, he gets involved in a car, in a motorcycle accident, and then he also passes on. Last year, ngo September, ngay one. You understand? So me dedicating my time to abantwana besikolo, it's me saying, I never had time with my children. Even though we spoke on the phone, they came with the visiting, but kaidile, and no one was a criminal gubo, bonke bafeba ama businessmen, both of them, you know. Though they were, you know, still studying up, you know.
Yeah.
But again, nevertheless, my time is dedicated to these children because if I had someone like me who can stand in front of the children and tell them, hey guys, there are ramifications to our actions.
Yeah.
And this is what you're going to suffer if you do this and that and that. I don't think I would have made my choices as I had made them previously.
Yeah.
You know, so Mina, I'm playing that part with these school children. I've got a foundation now, you know, it's only a month old, Trinity Community Foundation. I've got a company that will serve also as my brand when I explore other avenues trying to rebuild the man. You know, it's called Trinity Unleashed. It's got a website. And then, ngiyaza manje nale ama podcast, it helps more especially with your therapy. Yeah, because it helps ngayole. When you speak, you know, I could speak to you, tell the same story. It will not be verbatim as I would to Babumfundis or anybody else, but whatever it would unleash, going unleash maybe three aspects. Umfundisi keep a six, depending on the warmth and you feel as I speak to that particular somebody, you know. Yes, and it is my first time interview umuntu wesimame. So for me, it actually, you know, comforting in a sense. So yeah, thank you for the platform. And by the way, umsebenzi owenzayo, you don't know. You know, ngikhalela ukuza kule podcast. So that's how big your work is, you know, and it touches a lot of people because you delve into subjects, different subjects, and my subject wakhona a deep. And then they ngoba deep kanjalo. People don't want to tap on these toes.
That is London.
And I like the fact that you pour salt and you don't just pour a pinch. Like you pour salt on the wound and you make sure guti the person feels the pain. And you might not be a shrink, but I can tell you you're doing better than a shrink. Everybody who has a podcast.
I actually have a therapist as well that I go to, you know, just
you understand.
Offload as well.
Yes, but you doing greater than that therapist. I'm not undermining or underestimating, you know, they are.
I actually do see the results of people sitting on these couches and having these conversations. You know, we have reached an age where the things that we speak about, nobody, these type of platforms were never there in the past. And
absolutely.
I feel like this is such a privilege for even those that are younger than us because they don't have to suffer the way that we did.
Absolutely.
And the one thing that is still stuck in my head right now with the conversations that we're having now is the fact that this crime, you know, the crimes that you committed and everything, it's like there's an external force which is now on the inside of you, which drives you to do these things. It's like you're having an out-of-body experience. Right now, when you look at everything that you did, it's like, is that really me? You know? And I thank God because now, as you are in Christ and you are ministering the way that you are ministering and trying to change lives of children and make them have a different perspective of life, involving God without leaving God out of all of this. Because in as much as we can be therapists and be therapeutic and speak about these things, but without us having to invite God and also acknowledge Hori for these things to be possible, there has to be God.
Absolutely.
Because the crimes that you can commit and all these things, I do believe that there are people who were speaking back then.
Absolutely.
But your ears were shut because there was nothing which was saying, open up your ears. And I'm one person who strongly believes in praying for whatever message that you're going to put out there so that God can minister it in people's hearts so that it can change their lives. Mm-hmm. And what you're doing is amazing. Mm-hmm. And I really want to thank you from the bottom of my heart. I was saying to you before we started that I was watching your episode from Skim GP's mm-hmm. podcast. Listen, keep doing what you're doing. Mm-hmm. I do believe that God kept you alive for a time such as this.
For the purpose, yeah.
Yes, and you have to keep running your race. If God didn't want you to be alive, mm. to be preaching what you're preaching now, you wouldn't be here. Mm. You probably would have been dead at the accident or before you even went to prison, you know.
Absolutely.
So to God be the glory. Thank you so much.
Amen. God, to God be the glory. And before we could perhaps part, maybe people should get my numbers because I want them to get the numbers so that, you know, they help wherever they can help because, hey, I'm starting up and from ground zero. So, ngizama ngayo yonke indlela to, you know, do what is constructive and positive. Yeah. So, in number yam, I don't know if I should issue it now.
It.
Yeah. So, I've got two numbers. One is 084-528-3403. Okay. That's a number for calls. And the WhatsApp number, I think if they call me, they will get the WhatsApp number because I just recently got that now.
Okay. Also, I think we can arrange with Pastor Bay for the numbers to appear on the screen.
On
so
the
you
screen.
Can just forward the numbers to Kanye.
Oh, yes. Yeah. Ukanye le ang WhatsApp ngayo. That's the WhatsApp number.
Okay. Yeah, we'll have both the numbers on the screen.
Yeah.
Yeah, that would
be fine.
With that being said, thank you so much. A big shout out ne, to Sen Studios. We appreciate that. I feel like we are watching a soccer match. You know the way you gave us extra 15 minutes? Big shout out to Sen Studios, Pastor Bay, and Dibutin, her absentia, and the rest of the team. We appreciate you guys. Ne? And a big shout out to Crown Lioness, E2 her studio in her absentia. And who else am I forgetting? Hydro, you know, they're going to fire us. A big shout out to Hydro Quench. You guys, you are amazing. I really appreciate the amount of work that you're doing for us and just helping us push this ministry. We are out. God bless you and good night. Is it night? No. This thing's air. What time?
It's the afternoon.
It airs in the afternoon. Okay. Thank you so much.